Teachers of Reddit, what are some positive trends you have noticed in today's youth? As a health POV, students tend to be drinking a lot more water than when I was at school. Probably around 80% of kids tend to have water bottles, I've noticed now. I remember back in grades 1 to 5 I always saw people thanking the janitor. My dad would always tell me how that never happened back in his day. Man, the janitor was the most popular person at our elementary school. Probably just because he was a cool guy, but he'd play soccer with the sporty kids any recess he had the chance to, and when he made his rounds cleaning up during lunch he'd impress some kids by picking up bees by the wings. We'd practically jump at the chance to ask him if we could use the broom and pen and clean up for him. It was like a game, haha. Edit, nothing makes me happier than all the janitor/maintenance people appreciation going on right now. In high school we had one janitor. And that janitor loved everyone. In turn we loved him back. We found out his wife got cancer and he had to take vacation to stay with his wife. The students pressured the board to give him more vacation. And the students raised about $5,000 for him too. Art teacher here, my 6-year-old students are really good with encouraging statements, absolutely unprompted by us. We were working with clay and the shyest girl, who had never spoken once, said, "Wow Riley, you did a great job on your bunny. It looks beautiful," or when a girl cried because hers broke, a student said, "Don't worry Coco, you can repair it, it'll be okay," just very kind things like that, you wouldn't believe a 6-year-old would have the selflessness to say. I think if you watched some of the shows they watch, especially at that age, you'd find that they're mirroring things they've watched. Shows like Peppa Pig and Paw Patrol are full of examples like this for them to learn from. I'm drill instructor, fire department. I work for a career department, so the 18-19-year-old recruits I get aren't customers providing revenue by paying to be there, they're paid to be there and can be fired. It's a lot like the military, our academy was built around Paris Islands doctrine by a couple former Marine D's. A decade ago this was used to take advantage of them, badly. These days the wet behind the ears new high school grads are, so incredibly, remarkably intelligent. Gone are the days where a recruit will blindly accept information. Now I have yet to have a recruit contradict a direct order, but in the presentation of information they will ask pertinent questions that absolutely keep us instructors accountable. And if I don't know the answer oftentimes they will get on the internet and figure it out and bring it to me. Or they will bring several different possible answers to their questions and bring them to me for clarification. They also won't take injustice. In the fire service there is a long-standing rift between the old guard and the new. One former recruit was incorrectly disciplined for something he did not do, and it was proven as such. Unfortunately for him, his company officer and battalion officer were part of that old guard. Each emphatically urged him to take the discipline, a formal write-up, plus exclusion from the pertaining activity for 12 months, to not rock the boat since you're new. Obviously he didn't, he fought it and won. But the old guard slandered his name and dismissed him as one of those disrespectful, self-centered millennials. Thankfully that mentality seems to be here to stay, as I see it more and more with every recruit class that comes through. The old ways of blatant injustice mislabeled as how we did it or respect are disappearing. I was born in 82 and I was raised being told that I am required to obey instantly and take all punishments without protest, even when it turned out that my parents were mistaken, note, they were never wrong. They considered that a lesson in respecting your elders. Defending yourself was talking back or arguing. Parents never apologized either. I am so happy to see that changing. It was dehumanizing to grow up like that. Kids today are much more open with their feelings. I hear I love you so much more. Not between kids in relationships, but between friends, no matter the genders. It's an amazing and heartwarming thing to see/hear. My friend recently graduated while I'm still a high schooler and we were typing one day and she ended the conversation with, "I gotta go, love ya," and I'm not the type to hug a friend but I damn near cried at that love ya. I wasn't sure if we could keep in contact with her in college but I'm more confident now. They are not only more open about their own mental health, they are vigilant about their friends as well. Twice I've had students come to me concerned about a peer, once because a girl had started hurting herself and once because a boy was showing hints of suicidal thoughts. Both students are currently doing much better. We found out my daughter was self-harming and had suicidal ideations because her friends spoke up and asked the school counselor for help for their friend. How'd you react to that? As someone in your daughter's situation, I'm nervous about my parents finding out somehow. We sat her down one-on-one, and had a very emotional discussion about facts, and how many people I have known that have committed suicide, 19 years so far in the army, it's more common than it should be, and how that even I and my brother, her uncle, have been down dark roads before, but God help. Having had people close to me commit suicide, and having been through some training with the army, I made it abundantly clear that I would take any and every warning sign slash comment slash gesture slash etc. as absolute truth with zero bullshit, no matter what. Then, we started counseling and psych therapy, made her delete Snapchat off her phone, there seemed to be a lot of constant negative messages she was surrounding her time with, and started paying much closer attention to her digital life, while trying to be as unobtrusive as possible to allow a 13-year-old girl the room a 13-year-old girl needs. She's, seemingly, much improved now, continues in counseling, and has opened up to us that she's gay, so yay for positive and improved communication. All that being said, I cannot begin to know how your parents will react, but you should seek out help. Much like nobody would ever expect to just let a broken bone heal on its own, sometimes our brain organ needs help to heal. There are a ton of resources out there. Please memorize 1-800-273-8255, National Suicide Lifeline. They have a chat option if that's preferred. You can also text CONNECT to 741741 from anywhere in the USA, anytime, about any type of crisis. Here on Reddit there are also communities, although I don't know how helpful they may be. /r/stop self-harm /r/self-harm /r/suicide watch ton of resources in the sidebar. Finally, if you're in or around the San Antonio area, I would be willing to cook you a meal and help as I can. Obligatory edit, thanks for the gold. It depends so strongly on your parents as individuals. I will say though, as someone who was in your position around 4 years ago, if your parents get mad when they find out, they aren't mad at you. There's a lot of shock and confusion when parents find out SMTH like that about their kid. They're shocked and scared and confused about what you're going through and probably contemplating blaming themselves. If they seem mad at you initially, it's likely just them going through those emotions. Once they process it, they'll just want their child to get better. And when you're under 18, having your parents in on your issues is a huge help in accessing the resources to get better. Edit, because a lot of people are responding with similar things, not all parents are good parents. That's why I started by saying it'll depend on parents as individuals. I just wanted to encourage the opt to reach out if their parents are reasonable in general. I'm so sorry some of you have had the experiences you had with your parents finding out. You all deserve better. As a university history professor, I've noticed that even first-year students are more willing to express countering opinions and views. There are far fewer who just regurgitate my lectures and instead offer counterpoints and disagreement, which is an amazing trend for academic debate. It wasn't until graduate work that I really felt comfortable disagreeing with an assigned reading or a professor, and the level of understanding needed to synthesize your own counterargument is much higher than simple memorization. Edit, because it's been mentioned multiple times, I'm referring to well-reasoned disagreement, not flat earth conspiracies. In my class I often assign multiple readings on a single topic to showcase varying views, and in discussion and written responses I am encouraged to see students who are willing to state to a professor why they disagree with writer A, and to explain their reasoning. Occasionally I even throw in a trap reading, for example an editorial written by a radical Zionist when discussing mandatory Palestine, and I take special note of students who comment directly that the source is less credible because they took it upon themselves to look up the author and discovered their bias. To me, rote memorization of dates is largely useless, which is to say that I teach towards comprehension. For instance, I do not care that a student can from memory tell me that the Battle of Stalingrad ended on February 2, 1943, but rather that they can explain why the result of that battle was so influential in the eventual outcome of the larger war, with extra points if they can point to ways it contributed to the establishment of the Iron Curtain and the Soviet influence in Eastern Europe after the war. 95% of the things kids used to get bullied for 10 years ago are now largely accepted. When I was at school, the biggest bully used to abuse the nerds while actually boasting that he didn't even know how to turn a computer on. This will be my fourth year working with kids with disabilities. The severity ranges from mild to severe. Not once in my 4 years have I ever had a kid ask, "What's wrong with him?" I've never had a high-functioning individual question someone else. And I really like that. Being kinder to animals. Jerks I grew up with used to hit strays with stones and sticks. True, I see this trend even with bugs. I have a lot of kids try to keep or save ants or other bugs they find in the classroom rather than immediately decimate it. Although I will say I've also had kids eat the ants they find because they heard somewhere that ants taste kinda good. They reported back to me that the ants were spicy and that it felt as though the ant was crawling around inside their throat and then stomach. Gotta love middle school. More popular kid slash stronger standing up for the weaker slash different. Not a teacher. But a security officer in a college. I'd say they're better at forming their own opinions on issues and morals, which I would largely attribute to their access to the internet and thus getting to see and hear a wider variety of viewpoints. I remember when it used to be that my dad likes Bush so I like Bush kind of thing, but now I hear kids have actually individual viewpoints and intelligent conversations about world issues. Plus, I feel like they're more open and honest. It's not uncommon for kids to tell me how they're feeling or what's going on with them in their personal lives or what they think of what's going on with the class or me, usually all of this without any prompting. It helps me adjust to what they need and feel and want and also just helps us build that bond. When I was their age, 7th grade, I was a steel trap when it came to talking to teachers about what was going on with me, and pretty much all my peers were the same. I teach 2nd grade. They are much kinder and they are much better readers than kids even 10 years ago. Kinder, absolutely. My 2nd grader accidentally peed before he had pulled his pants all the way down, went to the bathroom too late. He was mortified to go back to class, and was crying. While the teacher was looking for something he could wrap around himself, a boy stood behind him to block the sight of his wet clothes. Another boy stood in front of him, and a third boy told him that happened to me once in kindergarten. I was embarrassed too. A single child laughed. When I was in 2nd grade, I can guarantee that everyone would have laughed at me. For days or weeks. When I was in 2nd or 3rd grade centuries ago, a similar thing happened to a sweet girl in our class. While some of us were more mortified and not sure what to do, the rest of the class, especially the boys, couldn't stop laughing at her. The teacher had no control over the class and had the poor thing embarrassingly walk out the class, I guess to the nurse's office or something. It must have been really bad, her parents transferred her out of school and I never saw her again. I wish we had the bandwidth to stand and protect her the way your 2nd graders did their peer. I'm surprised to have to scroll so far down to find this. Illiteracy was a problem well into the century, since lots of poor students would also mean they're not reading. Now, kids are immersed into reading at about the same time they can talk because of that evil cell phone technology. My girlfriend's 7-year-old daughter was already reading before kindergarten. I don't think we were taught to put letters together until the end of kindergarten or 1st grade, I can't remember. Students want to learn. This is something many people misunderstand, especially some teachers. Students want to learn, but education is so slow to respond to society, especially technology, that we're asking 21st century students to learn in a mid to late 20th century pedagogy. My school still argues about cell phone policies, instead of embracing phones as the amazing resource they are. Our district talks about going one-to-one with laptops, when it would make more sense to integrate proper smartphone use into curricula. Honestly, we have almost an entire generation that walks into classrooms with the most important communication and learning device ever created and we tell them to put them away. Edit, there is a famous quote about schools I like to remember, if you want to walk through a museum, walk around a high school. When kids actually commit to something they are extremely resourceful. I feel like it's being raised with the internet at their fingertips. My daughter is 4 and her preschool is teaching her Spanish. At home, when she wants to know the Spanish word for something, she asks me to Google it on my phone. It's so crazy. Funny you mention that. My grandma was born in the countryside of Argentina, and grew up without electricity, let alone TV, until her teens. Now she's living with me and constantly asks me ask the Spanish lady for the recipe of X. The Spanish lady is how she nicknamed Google Assistant. Seems like technology is making some big, positive changes to everyone who wants to learn stuff. Kids are incredibly intelligent. Because of the internet they have now they can learn about anything whenever and quickly. They also learn more because parenting is improved, teaching is improved and so they have so much more research on what they're doing that they become more efficient. The resumes I see from high school students are better than what I had graduating from college. I'd also second that they are much kinder. Some of the things I overhear flabbergast me with how different things are from when I was in high school 18 years ago. We're consistently teaching more life skills in high school as well. We teach resume writing in my senior English class, conduct mock interviews with real companies, our state requires a financial literacy course for a diploma, etc. As someone who works with a lot of interns and hires a lot of new grads, I second this. College kids are so remarkable nowadays, it continues to amaze me. They are so intelligent, hardworking, and driven to learn that I couldn't imagine my college self from 15 years ago surviving in today's world. Makes me feel great about the future. They're more pragmatic about the choices they make. Taking measures to reduce the amount of student debt they are going to accrue. They are also much more accepting of people of other cultures. Much less discrimination it seems. There is the common depiction of the entitled college student nowadays, but at least where I have been teaching in the Midwest, most students are holding down side jobs and generally working pretty hard. Edit, to stand on my soapbox for a sec, I'm a major advocate for higher ed and strive to help students land fruitful careers, but I'm also glad to see a trend toward encouraging technical school and trades. Nobody wants to see a young person go into debt by attending a school they're not sure they belong in, a field they're not sure they enjoy. There is serious pressure for young people to map out their entire professional lives at 18 years old. I think, in my experiences, the sense of entitlement can sometimes, not always, that's for sure, be misinterpreted as they are educated and know what they want and are willing to stand up for it. They know what they, and others, are capable of, and want to make it happen. This is it. Having spoken to many people in their 80s or 90s, they do not understand why kids these days won't just walk into any commercial building, ask for a job, and then stay for 40 years. My in-laws were pretty judgmental when I quit my job to go back to school because I was miserable. I have a much better one now and they're still confused. Yep. I'm basically on the knife's edge of being a millennial vs Gen Z and got called entitled by my older co-workers when I complained the company was paying me below market value for my skills. Number one thing my high school econ teacher taught me was that your wage is determined by scarcity above all else, not education or putting in your time, aka working hard to make someone else money. Had a hunch, looked for new jobs after a year and a day, and every single offer doubled if not tripled my salary while offering way better benefits, 401k match, 75% lower deductible. From friends who stayed at the firm, that apparently signaled to the older Gen X and boomer crowd exactly how f***ing greedy and disloyal I was, since someone so young shouldn't be worrying about retirement or healthcare. This is probably going to get lost, but I teach emotionally disturbed kids who can't attend mainstream high school because of their behavior. These are kids that treat the majority of the people they interact with like f***. They use slurs and swear and can just be all-round horrible to each other. We have one kid who's full-on autistic, but the parents refuse to have him diagnosed, so he's with us, not in an autism unit. They don't say a word to him. They listen to him rant about chickens and rabbits and even ask him questions about it. It's so bizarre to see kids frothing at the mouth and calling me a f***, and then gently redirecting the autistic kid away. They're so much more accepting of disabilities than my gen was. It's great. I graduated high school in 2010. A buddy of mine is autistic but relatively docile. He was never aggressive in any way, just highly excitable and would talk nonsense for the most part. Anyway, our class embraces this kid with open arms. You would've thought he owned the school, man. High fives, pats on the back, people greeting him as he walked through the hallways. I ate lunch with him every day my junior year along with a group of the more popular kids who loved him despite being the cool kids of the group. We had our own little call and response type thing whenever he saw me. He never got tired of it. I remember one time I happened to be walking to my locker during class and I saw a couple VPS kind of cornering this kid and talking gently to him. He was having a bit of an episode and was extremely distressed about something and he wouldn't cooperate with the administration. I asked if I could talk to him and they said sure. So I greeted him how I always would, hey so and so, what's up? What are we doing tonight? And he grinned and came over and slapped me on the back. The same thing we do every night, Ethan's Madra, try to take over the world. We took a little stroll and by the time we came back he was all good. I graduated and didn't see him for a few years. One time I was back home for a few nights and ran into him at a pizza place. I was curious if he would remember me. He came up and slapped me on the back and said, hey, Ethan's Madra, what are we doing tonight? Man, I swear I almost cried. Edit, thanks to several people for the silver and gold. Shout out to my parents for raising me to treat everyone with dignity and respect.